Thank you all very much for coming tonight on this balmy fall evening. I'm Susan Dimmick. I am chair of the school board's Health and Wellness Advisory Committee, and we are happy to have you come out tonight to learn more about vaping. This will be the first in a series of talks that we'll put on for this year, and we would greatly appreciate it if you could sign in. We'll be sending around some sign-in forms if you haven't signed in already. This will allow us to send a short survey to you to gain your input on this evening's presentation and also to find out from you what you would like in future programming. I'm sure you've all followed the news and heard about vaping. If you've seen the recent New York Times, then you've read that 9% of 8th graders, 20% of 10th graders, and a quarter of 12th graders have tried nicotine vaping products in the past month, so it's here whether we like it or not. Today my hope is that you'll come away from this talk knowing more about vaping and also what's going on in our schools. We'll leave ample time at the end for questions, and I would ask that you would hold your questions until we've heard from all of our speakers. First, I'd like to introduce to you Leonardo Espina. He is the supervisor of the Wellness Health Promotion and Prevention team for the Fairfax Falls Church Community Services Board. He holds a baccalaureate degree in psychology from the University of Puerto Rico and a master's in social work from George Mason University. The core of his work is educating the community on mental health and highlighting the importance of wellness. Leonardo and his team are committed to building the capacity and resilience of communities, families, organizations, and youth. And we're happy to have him here with us tonight. Thank you.
I was invited here today as so-called expert, so I'm trying to live up to, in at least in presentation, to that name. So thank you, Susan, for the wonderful introduction. Thank you for having me. Thank you for coming here on Wednesday evening and spending time with us. As was mentioned before, this is not just a topic that I've kept an eye out for the past 2 or 3 years. It is now hitting our front doors, it is hitting our front papers, and it is very, very much with the time. So without further ado, this was a presentation that we developed because we knew that this was something that we wanted to address more and more. I am the supervisor of the Wellness Health Promotion and Prevention Unit. So we try to build the capacity of the community. We hold trainings, presentations. We deal with issues that the youth in our communities might be confronting. And I've seen that vaping, electronic cigarettes, juuling has been something on the up and up. And we'll take a look at what the numbers look like. I'll also give you an idea of what the things look like sometimes, because they change and trends change. We put it the new look of nicotine addiction, because it's not about one thing, it's about a series of things that we've been seeing, right? And it is what we're talking about. What we're talking about is nicotine addiction in particular, right? Because what we've seen is that this is the outcome of now a wave of new influx of things. And there is good news to this. This is not a horror story. So we'll get to it. So some of the things that we'll talk about today, we'll talk about the evolution of e-cigarettes and vaping. We'll talk about the evolution of those terms as well, because we've heard different terms for different things, right? And we'll talk about how we can label it and how we can identify it correctly. I'll talk about on the trends that we're seeing with e-cigarette use. I'll hint on some other tobacco products and some of the good news that we see there. And then we'll end with what can parents do to assist our youth, but that doesn't have to be a parent. In Fairfax County, we have the 3 to Succeed, and that identifies the importance of youth having one trusted adult. It doesn't say one trusted parent, it doesn't say one trusted male or female, it's just that one trusted adult. Never underestimate the value of connection in a child's life, okay? So I am shortening this presentation. That was a video, it's a YouTube video, just a background on e-cigarettes. So I'll move quickly on some slides, but I wanna stay where I think the meat of this presentation is, and I think where I think the meat for you guys is going to be at. So feel free to stop me at any point if I'm going a little bit too fast. So just a little bit about vaping. It goes by many names. So vaping, e-cigarettes, juuling, electronic nicotine delivery system, or ENDS. So when you go to a conference with, you know, people in suits and very small professionals, they'll say ENDS a lot. Something that I found very interesting, I just came back from a conference a couple of weeks ago, and they changed ENDS, and I believe it's EDS instead of nicotine delivery system. Does anybody want to know why? Because somebody said drugs in the back. That's usually that's the right answer. If you're any doubt, just shout out drugs. Because some of these systems, the way they operate with their heating elements, and I'll get into it in a little bit. You guys laugh, so we're off to a good start. You may use something else other than nicotine. Okay, for example, THC oil. So for example, this presentation in some atmospheres can sort of lean into what are we seeing with substance use as well in our youth, because it's all moving towards this thing that I call bigger and better, right? Our youth do everything bigger and better. They arrived in the US around 2007, so you notice that it's almost 12 years ago. I know it seems like yesterday, but that's 12 years ago, but it's only currently where we've seen a deep rise. It's, like I said, obscure market, and a tobacco-free alternative. So basically, at first, at the beginning, it's for smokers or people who were trying to quit smoking, for example. It's a safer alternative to cigarettes, for example. Right now, we have a $22 billion global industry, okay? And then we have over 400 brands and 6,000 flavors. The biggest indication that I know that this is a thing is that the first thing that tobacco manufacturers started doing is putting money into it. If you look at any of the major brands, if they make cigarettes, they're making electronic devices, right? So all major tobacco brands in the United States right now have money in stake in electronic nicotine delivery systems. Okay, so I'll make this interactive. If you were to describe some of these pictures, how would you describe them? Candy.
Kid friendly.
Fun, exactly, right? I don't know if you can read that. It says Fanta, right? It's lively, live colors, right? So one of the things that e-juice and e-delivery system manufacturers did very well is that they went back to what works. And if you know anything about advertising, to the tobacco industry knows what works, because they were doing this 80 years ago, right? It's let's make it kid friendly, let's make it lively, let's make it joyful. And now what the last trend is doing, it's let's make it cool. Right, because that's the last thing that was shown. I was just talking to someone how when the data breaks down, that's what they found, is that they found that they made it cool. Okay, so this is national youth data. This isn't localized, so just on a national scale. In 2018, we saw about 20% of high school students reported using e-cigarettes at least once a day in the last 30 days. Now, I like to put the other number because it's a little bigger. That's 3 million kids. When I say kids, youth, children, right? That's a lot, okay? The reported use increased from 78% from 2017 to 2018, and by 2018, 4.9% of middle school students reported using e-cigarettes, and then the reported use increased 48%. To me, that's the most important. So here in Fairfax County, to give you an example, 12th grade use is always gonna be the highest in pretty much every substance, so across the board, alcohol included. When I looked at vaping, we've had the Fairfax County data for electronic cigarettes for 3 years. And we are privileged because that question had to be inserted in the youth survey. Is everybody familiar with the youth survey by any chance? I'll backtrack. The youth survey is basically a huge long questionnaire that is given to all students within Fairfax County. Last year we received, I was looking at the numbers, around 33,000 surveys that were usable. So it's a good sample on any number of behaviors and components within our youth. In the last 3 years, we saw electronic cigarette use go from 9% to about 12%, and now to about 25%. That's the concern. That's why I was waiting on that third year, because that growth is exponential. So think about it. First, I made $9,000 a year. Then I made $12,000. Now I'm making $25,000 a year. You'd be ecstatic, because that growth is incredible. On the other side, it's something that we want to get ahead of, because I don't want to see is that exponential growth going forward, right? And then we see that the Admiral Jerome M. Adams issued an advisory on late in December, and those advisories just keep coming, especially now. So this presentation was created before the past month of we've had with CDC and FDA warnings. You know it's really bad when the FDA might recommend that people stay off electronic cigarettes and go back to traditional smoking. Okay. So you see that 2018, 27.9 of 8th, 10th, and 12th graders reported vaping at least once. That number in particular, I believe, is almost about 40 to 50% now. So that's once, not necessarily regular use, but that means that I'm trying it, right? And then you see that in 2015, it was 5.7, okay? That's that exponential growth. I'm not interested necessarily in the numbers, I like trends. That means to me that it's just becoming okay, that more people are doing it or I'm seeing it more. I started hearing about this, I remember, and I'm going a little bit off topic, I was at another parent chat with a parent liaison, and it was about alcohol. And parent liaison comes to me, and she's like, Leo, my middle school kids are telling me about this thing, and they've been finding USB things in their tables. And I'm thinking to myself, like, oh, wow, I don't know what she's talking about. Like, I just got to sit here and drone off. And about a month later, they told me about juuling. This was years ago. And I was like, oh, she did know what she was talking about. And this was about 2 years ago. Now juuling is a thing. And when I say that they made it cool, is because I remember I was at a conference once and they were talking about marketing and advertising. And nowadays we talk about social media, right? So I was like, let me see if this is true. So I pulled up, and I'm a human being, and I have a personal Instagram account that I won't give you access to. But I looked it up and I was like, Juul, right? Flabbergasted. Just page after page after youth. Because it's become popular. It's become something that I do without any stigma, for example. Nowadays, I was talking to a parent when I was doing smoking prevention with middle school, elementary school, it would take 5 minutes. Oh, does anybody of you smoke or know anybody that smokes cigarettes? No, Leo, that gives you cancer. I don't do that. And they would shut it down immediately. The good news is that we've seen cigarette smoking rates at the lowest that we've ever seen them. It's barely 1%, right? And this is the flip side, right? Because it seems and it's sold as a safer alternative, right? So the evolution of e-cigarettes, this is why it becomes a little bit complicated. When they started, it looked like a fake cigarette, right? Anybody remember that? That it looked just like a plastic e-cigarette? That's where the term electronic cigarette came from. And that's why, if I want to replace the cigarette, I look like a cigarette, it's just electronic, it's a little safer, and it just had that nicotine. Then we moved to what they call the vape pen, right? So it looks a little bit longer. Basically, they're all going to work in the same sort of an environment. And then we have the third generation, which is usually called a mod, M-O-D, right? They all going to work in the same way. This one is a little bit bigger, but that's a battery. There's going to be a heating element in the middle, usually some metal device, which heats up the liquid, and then the liquid creates a vapor. Now, I was asked by another parent, it is not vapor. Right? Vapor isn't produced. It might call the vaping or the smoke. It's just an aftermath of heating the liquid element. It also has that secondhand and third hand smoke effect where it lies, right? Because the vapor comes out, but it has to settle. And then it may stay on your clothes, it may stay on your fabrics, it may stay in, just like smokers, right? Same thing happens with vapor. It's just a little bit lighter because it doesn't smell like tobacco. It doesn't smell like burning because there's no ignition. And e-cigarettes do not contain tobacco, but they do use nicotine from the tobacco plant. And then nicotine is the addictive ingredient. That's the one thing that's missing, right? Now, Juul is the game changer, right? So the primary feature of the Juul cigarette is that the fact that the e-liquid contains nicotine salts extracted from leaf-based tobacco. This nicotine salt is completely different. So those other e-cigarettes, let's say regular e-juice has a concentration of nicotine in it, anywhere from 3 to 8, 12% at the most, right? When you talk about Juul, you're talking about exponential growth. So you're talking about 20 to 30% nicotine. So even though it's a smaller size and canister, it has exponentially more nicotine than other methods of vaping. And when this is the electronic cigarette or vaping product of choice for youth, that's very concerning. So for example, if you've heard of youth becoming addicted to nicotine, it's because their bodies have been accustomed to that delivery of nicotine in their system. Okay? And what we're seeing now with youth that are doing that on a regular basis is, let's say I'm vaping on a regular basis, I go to school, I forget, they see it, somebody confiscates my vape, I may have nicotine withdrawals, right? Because now, anybody have coffee every day? I have coffee every single day. Anybody go with coffee one day? Yeah, same thing, right? Your body gets used to having that chemistry. And when the thing that I try to do is when we're talking about youth, everything changes, right? Because when we're talking about youth, it's not only the body dependency, it's the changes in the development. And what we've seen is one of the biggest markers for substance use is gonna be tobacco and nicotine use early, because it affects body development. Most importantly, it affects brain development, right? And that's a big indicator. So how does it work? I like to leave it, I was gonna see if anybody saw it. I left it here on purpose. I was gonna try to see the computer. I'll lift it up in a second. You'll see it's incredibly tiny. It's incredibly slim. I can hide it. So in comparison to other devices, this device produces very little smoke. It's a very small puff, so it's harder to detect, and it doesn't have a powerful odor. Like if I were to light a cigarette inside this room, everybody would know probably, and it would smell. And if I leave to go to another room, you're like, ooh, Leo smoked a cigarette. If I were to puff off this Juul, or I went in the back of the room, probably nobody would notice. I remember because I was walking around my neighborhood and there was somebody walking their dog. And they were on their phone and all of a sudden I saw a small cloud of smoke and I was like, wait, what is that? And they were Juuling. And I was like, that's how inconspicuous it is. And they were holding it something like this where you can't see it because it's small, right? So one of the biggest things that we do is I bring it so you can touch it. I tried to move the laptop, but I was unable to because of the wiring. There is a Juul connected to this laptop. Anybody see it? I guarantee you I can do a whole presentation with that Juul connected to that laptop and nobody's gonna say anything. Even if you do maybe know, you're like, maybe, is that a Juul? I'm not sure. No, it's just this, might be a Wi-Fi antenna or his USB drive. It's actually charging right now. I didn't mean to, but it's on. So you can see that the light is on, right? Where do you think we got these materials? Huh? The school system, yes. I was talking to one of my managers and we were like, can we use money to buy Juuls? Can I buy Juuls to show the parents? Like, I don't know. I'm serious, like, is the county gonna be okay with me going to 7-Eleven and buying Juuls? And I probably could, by the way, just because of the nature of our business. But they're like, no. And I met one of the school folks, they're like, oh, do you need some stuff? And the funny thing is, and I'm like, I got stuff. That's funny, because that's exactly how he said, I have stuff. And if you need more stuff, I can get more stuff. And the funny is, it's in a bag, there's juice all over. If you notice, they're in Ziploc bags because they drip, so there's juice. My staff has to wear gloves and clean it out because, you know, these are the things that you can look out for example. You know, the smells, the things. You see some different alternatives, the little bottles of refillables, the cartridges, they're this small. You know, these are things that I had to learn. I was literally trying to break down one of the ones that I haven't seen before, because these are things that continuously change. And these are, it's like trending topics. Anybody have any teenagers? I know. Speaking to the crowd, right? Do their fashion trends change or modify or fluctuate in any way, shape, or form? Well, guess what? So do their electronic nicotine delivery devices, right? There's one, I think, somewhere that has a sticker wrapped around it because he wants to be fashionable with his jewel, right? Remember, this is also a social aspect to it. Anybody, when everyone was growing up, anybody remember the smoking crowd? Right? When I grew up, there was a smoking cigarette crowd, and that was part of a way for me to identify with other people. So nowadays, what we're seeing is this, much of the same thing, is that this is a way for me to identify with other people. The way that I talk about youth is they want to be the same but different. I want to be unique, but God forbid that I isolate. I want to fit in, right? And that's what they're looking for, and this has become another niche in one of those places. There you see the USB. I mean, this is what I said about youth being bigger and better, right? It doesn't get much better than your nicotine delivery device can be charged by a USB port. Right? Effects of cigarettes and nicotine. So the biggest one is that brain development piece, because it literally changes and modifies the sections of your brain that are associated with addiction and that are associated with pleasure. Because now I know, right? And it makes you more susceptible to having issues in the past. Obviously, anything that you inhale, any smoke that you inhale is not good for you. It's just that simple. That's what I say to adults and youth. If you're inhaling it and it's a smoke, it's probably bad for you. Okay? This is another short video. There you see the Sorens that I have on the table, so they might look a little bit different than the Juuls. Much of the same concept. So you're gonna have a liquid cartridge you can refill, and it's gonna have a battery operated. You can charge it with, anybody have an Android phone? Same charger, you don't even have to swap it out. Most of the bigger ones that you have a micro USB port that you can just connect right through. Okay, I'm not sure if it's big enough, but this is a hide and seek exercise. Anybody see anything that might seem curious, out of place, or it might warrant a conversation? Okay.
Yeah, the shaving canister.
The shaving canister, why?
Because there's aerosols in there, something that they can cut or...
Now I'm super interested in what you guys are going to say. Okay.
Dab City.
Dab City, why?
Because they call it dab.
Dab. Everybody know what a dab is?
No.
This blew my mind a couple years ago because I'm hip and young, right? I'm sorry? No, ma'am. There is. Does anybody know the dab? I'm not going to do it. No. It's being recorded. I forgot. So dabbing is a process in which marijuana is, I am going to get this wrong, and it is very, it's as insane as I'm going to describe it. Marijuana is diluted, then it's frozen and broken down where the THC is extracted from it with either helium or hydrogen, if I'm not mistaken, then it's made into a wax. Yes, then it's broken down and sort of like in crystals, and that wax is dabbed with extreme heat, and it's called taking a dab. A couple of things, extremely concentrated, right? So if we talk about like marijuana nowadays being extremely high in THC content, dabbing is exponentially more concentrated. The process is not scientific, as you may have sort of gathered from that, so you don't know what you're taking or doing. So that's called dabbing. Okay, just a little. Talking way too much.
What do they do to the wax? Do they eat it or what?
You smoke it. Yes. So it looks like almost a crystal, and you smoke it in a different way, and it's THC concentrate, pretty much. Yeah. Anything else? Yes. I was gonna see if anybody reckon. Does anybody wanna know what Four Loko is? So another. Too proud for that one, sir. He's like, yeah, I do. I've never had it. I've heard it through the grapevine. I'm from another country, so I didn't. Four Loko is sort of a fruity alcoholic beverage And I think if it has energy enhancers in it as well, if I'm not mistaken. Yes. So, and Four Loko is a prime example of the bigger and better piece. So one of the things that the market has done as a whole, if you're a beer drinker, you'll notice this. In the past 20 years, alcohol percentage in most alcoholic beverages has gone up, right? Average alcohol content in beer went from about 3.5 to about 7. And when Budweiser and big beer manufacturers do that, it's because that's where the market is going, right? So a couple of things there. You have the e-juice, right? You have the trends, you have the Four Loko, you have the Obsidi. These are not well, but you can see some of the jewels and the jewel cartridges on the bed, right? We're probably gonna do a lot more because there's a lot more of things like the Dab City piece. There's a lot of wear. If you'll allow me 1 second. I don't have it, but somebody gave my staff this. Anybody recognize this? It's sort of an Apple Watch sort of looking device, right? Surprise, it's actually an electronic smoking device. The middle of the watch actually comes apart and you can vape from it. There's another one that I've seen that is a great concern, it's a hoodie. And with one of the strings from the hoodie is a vaping device, and you can just put it to your mouth. So there's little things like this that we're hoping to, I know my manager, because she saw, and there's other presentations on little things that you can watch out for that might, if I don't know what dabbing is, I might not be aware, and then all of a sudden Leo has a shirt that's, you know, dab for life. And I think it's the, you know, I'm dabbing for life. You know, it's for charity. Dab for charity, right? So these are the little things. Yeah. And most of the time it'll be underneath. It'll be very, very subliminal. It'll be sort of a college shirt, but you know, high for life kind of deal, where it's not overt. And it's very, very tricky, especially with some of our youth who might not even know. They're just like, oh, I like that shirt, right? So cigarettes, I'll breeze through because I don't want to take too much of your time. But like I said, I think our latest polls are around less than 1%. The biggest thing, do I have any cigarette smokers here? Yeah. The interesting thing is I wanted to ask that for a reason, because even if there's a cigarette smoker here, because of the nature of our society and our culture, I'm less likely to raise my hand. 20 years, 30 years ago, I'd probably raise my hand and not think twice. Now it's like, I'll give you an example. I've smoked cigarettes in my lifetime. It's embarrassing to say it in public, right? That's one thing that youth has worked really, really, really well. We've done that really well. We've hardened that message for so long that it's worked. Our youth do not smoke cigarettes, which was a bigger change when I grew up, probably about 20 years ago. I still saw people in my community, my family, my schools that still smoke cigarettes. So we've done very well. So we can do this again. This is a message that can be done. Okay, hookah. Does anybody know what hookah is? Yeah, another one that sort of gained a lot of momentum in the United States. So just in case you don't, basically same sort of concept. You have this bowl up top which holds tobacco. Now it is tobacco, right? So usually youth has no idea. When I talk to youth and they're like, oh, that's tobacco. No, it isn't. It's like flavored stuff, Leo. My family was like, no, it has flavor, but it's tobacco. So it's concentrated tobacco up top, usually with some type of molasses, a heating element on top. Then the air goes through the water, which does not filter the smoke. The water does nothing to the smoke. It just makes bubbles. It does not take away the bad stuff. It does not hold. No, it is not a Brita filter. That is not how that works. I say that for a reason. That's what youth, I was just talking to some people where it's like, the first thing I do with youth is tell me what you know so I can dispel that and just throw it away and then go from there, right? The big one is a 60-minute session of hookah is 100 or more cigarettes. And by the way, 60 minutes of hookah is not uncommon because it's very much, if you notice, there's two hoses on that. So that means that we can go to a place, rent a hookah, sit down and just hookah for one or any number of hours, right? And because it's so social, right? That's the difference between, for example, e-cigarettes and traditional cigarettes. If I'm vaping, I don't have to stop. I can vape and vape and vape. If I have a cigarette, the cigarette is gone, I'm usually, okay, I'm done, end of that activity. I can vape for 30 minutes straight. And if I have another cartridge, I just stick another cartridge in it. So my nicotine intake can be continuous. There's a difference. Same thing with that hookah. Is as long as I keep using it, I still have that nicotine intake. So cigars, same thing. We have, these are what we consider cigars or cigarillos. Those are also used for marijuana smoking. So as a wrapper. Some of them will just bring a wrapper. And then you fill in with marijuana. Okay, smokeless tobacco, bigger in some rural areas or in certain sectors, for example, right? Okay, so what can parents do? Get educated, educate your youth, positive and supporting. The no nagging rule applies, right? The nagging isn't effective. What you can do, the first part you got down is you're here. So that means that I'm learning and I can be a fountain of information. That means that I have doubts, I can seek information. I can tell you right now, there are tons and tons of reliable sources that you can get information on. And what I tell parents is you should be your youth's number one resource. Because if you aren't, I know who is going to be. Guess who's going to be? Usually they're friends. And they all have one thing in common, is the lack of development in their prefrontal cortex, which is the part of the brain that uses good judgment. That's why I remember my grandmother used to tell me every time I left the house, good judgment in Spanish. I didn't know what she was saying. I think it was this unconscious knowing, like, use it, let's go, you can do it, right? So being the source of information, and if you don't know, hey, let's go look it up. No, not at that website. How about we go to the FDA website? Or we go to the NIDA website, or I think the CSB has something, or I see Fairfax or something, right? And we can make it an activity, right? We can see what's in there. Ensure that your children know your family rules about tobacco. Well, they should know, Leah. Sometimes it's just me verbalizing it. I say this with alcohol as well. Well, of course they know that, you know, that's gonna ruin their brain development. Or of course they know that I wouldn't be okay with it, right? I think it's, in our last, one of the things that we talk about with youth and parents is perception, and it's the youth perception of how their parents feel about some things. With electronic cigarettes, I think it's 50-50, by the way. So 50% of youth might say that their parents think that them using electronic cigarettes is either a little bit wrong or not wrong at all. Now, if I ask parents, that's probably different. But there's that sort of mild disconnect. Okay? So a couple of tips, be patient. There's no perfect time to talk, right? Perfect time probably right now because you can bring it up as a social situation. Did you hear that thing about the news today? Did you hear about that vaping thing? I went to this great presentation. It was amazing. The speaker was so engaging. He really knew what he was talking about, right? I like this one. Because God forbid we ask our youth what they're thinking. God forbid we ask them what their situation in school is. Or if they've even tried to use an electronic cigarette. Because God forbid they experiment anything in life. Right? Our youth are going to go through their obstacles, like we all have. I think our job is to open that door of communication where we can have a conversation of something that I guarantee, at this point I feel very, very comfortable guaranteeing that our youth within Fairfax County, Fairfax City, Falls Church City, they will encounter electronic nicotine delivery systems. There is no doubt in my mind. Just like I guarantee you that they might encounter alcohol as well, right? When you sit down and watch Sunday Night Football, the Coors Light commercial is coming, regardless. It's about the conversations that we have and what type of relationship we establish where we can have that conversation, okay? So there's a bunch of resources as well for youth. There's a bunch of online and texting resources. There's even a texting quit line that people can get support and even one-on-one counseling through the phone. So there's also cessation devices. And I know that the way that we're moving because of these numbers, there's going to be more and more resources, hopefully, for intervention and treatment for youth as well. So if you've already are using a nicotine delivery system, what can we do about it? Because you know that body develops that dependence fairly quickly. Good news, guys. I told you it wasn't all horrible. Okay. So in 2019, Virginia Governor Ralph Northam signed House Bill 2748 into law. Tobacco 21. So you must be 21 to buy tobacco, nicotine, and vapor products, including e-cigarettes. I can tell you personally, from doing this professionally, that was a shock to me. In no way, shape, or form did I think that policy was going to go through, because Virginia is, for many extent purposes, a tobacco state. So many of our efforts were never policy-based, because it was, so that is amazing, right? And hopefully that's one of the things that we see in the long term going nationwide as well. And then that went into effect actually on July 1st. And that is a huge, huge step. And that's it for me. You can clap, yes, yeah, you can.
Thank you, Leo, for being here tonight. Good evening, everybody. I'm Peter Noonan. I'm the superintendent of schools here in the city of Falls Church. Don't go too far, Leo, because I'm sure there are going to be a lot of questions. I just wanted to first and foremost say one of the things that Leo had in his slide that I think is probably most important is that you're here and you're learning. And you're seeing what the products actually look like. You see how insidious some of these products are and how hard they are to detect. So does anybody want to be a superintendent? but you get the idea of how difficult it is to detect these things. But being here and being able to have a conversation with your youth is extremely important. One of the things that I also wanted to mention was just sort of at a policy level from the school division's perspective. We do have a couple of school board members here tonight. We've got Greg Anderson, who's here this evening. Thank you, Greg, and Shauna Russell, who's also here, is that in the last 4 months or so, we did update the school board policy to include e-cigarettes and vapes and the like. And it was really a complex and really interesting conversation, because we were trying to figure out how do you capture all of these different devices within a singular policy. And I think we did a pretty good job of coming up with something that was broad enough that captured everything. So from a policy perspective, we have some policies in place here in the City of Falls Church Schools that are meant to help support our school principals, who you're going to see tonight as well, in their quest and endeavor to ensure that we're on this and really kind of paying attention and working with our youth. One of the other things I want to say tonight also is that, and the data from Fairfax County is pretty compelling, because it is right next door to the City of Falls Church and surrounds us in many ways, is that this issue of vaping is typically with older kids, so I would say middle and high school age students. And one of the things that we know, and it's sort of a dichotomy almost, there is this sort of gradual release of responsibility as students get older, and we do that in schools, right? The older our students get, the more we want to release responsibility to them and let them kind of run with their learning, run with their social decision making, etc. But I am a parent of an adolescent boy as well, and I feel like, and I would say this to you, and I think it's fair, and that is that our kids that are in grades 6 through 12 need us more now than they needed us when they were young. So all of that to say that being in that moment and having those great conversations and relationships are extremely important, because at the end of the day, the school system can't solve this problem. This really is a community issue, and it's something that all of us together can work on. And ultimately, when we come together and we have these good conversations with our youth, we can begin to erode at some of these negative behaviors that we're seeing utilizing these vapes and the like. Two other very quick things. One is, One just escaped me. The second one is that we are videotaping this, and so we will post this on our website here in the City of Falls Church Schools, and we'll be, and we will continue to be educating with materials and resources through the morning announcements and the like so that the broader message can get out to the community. One of the questions that you might have is, so are our staff familiar with some of these devices? And do they know what they're looking for? And we started the education process last year, actually in the spring, educating our staff and faculty with some information that we sent out via some articles to read and to look at that sort of described what some of these devices look like. And we will continue in that vein as well. So I just wanted to give you kind of the policy perspective, the high level look, but also sort of reinforce to you that this is something that we are paying attention to, and it is worrisome to us that our students and our youth and our community are using these devices, and we're committed to working with you as a partner to eradicate this, or at least erode it to a point where it begins to fall off. So that's the high level. I want to give you an opportunity to hear from our principals too. So this evening we have Valerie Hardy, our principal at Henderson Middle School, and we have Matt Hills, our principal at George Mason High School, who will kind of give you the on-the-ground feel of what's happening in their schools respective to vaping and the like. So I'll turn it over to you. Thank you very much.
Kind of tag team, and does that work for you?
Yes. Principal Hills.
Hi, everybody. Valerie Hardy, good to see you. Good to see so many familiar faces. I think on the ground, much of what we were hearing tonight is very similar, and I want to kind of reiterate that piece of a critical friend. Much of the information that we tend to receive about students and vaping does come from that critical friend who has told a trusted adult. Right? And that information does make its way to our school-based administration. We also hear from you all, parents, right, that you've seen or heard or suspect of things that are happening. I can tell you now, going on my third year, our statistics are way lower than that. It doesn't mean that we're immune, right? Our students do certainly not have their prefrontal cortex developed, right? And that piece of trying to experiment and figure out what it is, it's just there, right? But where I think we have the benefit, and he's going to be mad that I'm going to call on him, but Mr. Coffrin, who is our PE, health and PE teacher, it's a piece of our education in the curriculum. And from that same approach of wellness and your health, right? Our students hear that message, right? They hear the dangers. And oftentimes, as we've unpacked sort of how have you gotten access, where did this come from, right? Unfortunately, I do have a handful. It's a very small handful of vapes and jewels that have been collected. It's how did you get access to it, right? And I think some of the things that I would maybe say as a parent, right, that I would maybe also put on your radar are how are they financially getting it, right? Gift cards, right? Visa gift cards. They're not traceable, right? Mailing addresses, online dealers, right? Places where they can mail. And that's information that I know students have shared with us as we have these conversations around the how and the why. And I think that's important as a parent for you to also hear as well, because as Dr. Newton shared, it's a community effort. And that's something that I wanted to make sure came across today. But I would say from the middle school perspective, our statistics are far smaller than sort of what we saw represented here. And Principal Hills and I were speaking about it's our year for the youth survey, we believe, coming up. So that'll be good data for us to also see and be able to look at and dissect and see what we need to do next.
Well, and as Principal Hardy said, at the high school, we have a very similar perspective in terms of what we're seeing. I know I was sitting with the Health and Wellness Committee last year at this exact time talking about the numbers and what they look like and the increase of referrals associated with this. The numbers have declined a bit, and you know, I'm hopeful that that's because we do have such an intelligent student body who is really taking ownership of this, and that's kind of where I wanted to start. And Leo doesn't know this, but you're going to be joining this committee because you were spot on with a lot of different things that you were talking about. But I had an opportunity to meet with my executive board, my group of SCA student representatives, and we've been working on this since last year. I think the best message that we can deliver from the high school perspective is, okay, the voice needs to be coming from the students. And I'm telling you, we have a group of students who do want to eradicate this. It's a mission of theirs. They are, you know, a full go in terms of what they want to see in terms of changes. I've had students come to me and say, Mr. Hills, I don't like it that every now and then I may walk into the bathroom and I may see something like this. Or, you know, outside of school, I walk into a party and I feel like there's this element of peer pressure, as Leo described. That's something that we're really trying to change. And so, you know, we've been sitting down and talking about, what does this effort look like? You know, from the student voice, how can we make sure that we develop a consistent and positive message where students understand, you know what, here are the expectations in school, outside of school. Obviously, here are the consequences, but are the consequences really going to drive home what we're asking the students to do? I don't know if that's the case. And so we're kind of putting together, I'm actually meeting with my executive board on Friday to kind of put together a grassroots effort to make sure that our students feel supported by one another. And they're the ones who are really kind of delivering this message with the support of the teachers and the administration. As Principal Hardy mentioned, in our health and PE curriculum, we're definitely talking about that. We also have a program, an advisor program where we're asking guest speakers to come in and meet with the students and talk about, you know, really through the lens that I think Leo did, where it's, you know, you're making it personal. You're actually breaking it down and saying, look, we recognize that there are students that are going to continue to do this regardless of what we say or what we tell them could harm them. But here are some of the reasons why your fellow classmates are saying that it's not a good thing. And so I think bringing that whole piece together is definitely what we're trying to accomplish at the high school.
One final piece I would sort of speak to is what's hugely helpful, I think, for both of us also being learners with you tonight is the evolution, right? You sort of saw some of those pictures of how the products have evolved. And, you know, Mark's probably back there laughing a little bit. It's how do we keep our staff on the lookout for the evolution of the product that's sort of a little bit a step ahead of us. And thankfully, I've found a little bit ahead of where our kids are. In that regard, so that is a little bit of peace of mind. But I do think it's food for thought for us in terms of how do we continue to make sure that our staff are on the lookout for the right things, right? These we know, right? These we're familiar with. But as products evolve, as my goodness, you said big money, right, coming in from the cigarette and tobacco companies, as they continue to put money into the products, how are we sort of staying up to speed on what it is that we're looking for so that we can be proactive in seeing and identifying it when we see it?
And that's a critical piece, because if the kids recognize that the adults understand what this all is, that's going to allow us to do what I think you are looking for, which is to kind of eradicate it as much as we can. And I think that's an important piece. Yep, definitely about the partnership.
Thank you very much. That was really interesting and good to learn more. I would like to open it up to questions now. And I'll maybe, if I can invite you all to hang out by the microphone, and they'll repeat your questions since we're videoing. So when you answer they'll repeat your question and then answer. Okay.
A couple of questions. There's been a lot of reports in the news recently about the deaths and health problems from vaping. Do you think that that's happening? Are you seeing that having any impact on kids and their perception about vaping? That's my first question. The second is, I've heard a concern that controlling the market is driving people to, or kids to buy cartridges, black, you know, on the black market that God knows what's in it. And so I was just wanted your thoughts on that as well.
So I think I'll take the second question, and I'll leave it to them to see what they're seeing with the youth in particular. As far as the second question is, if controlling the market and the age limiting is causing youth to go to the black market and buy what they call black market cartridges or generic cartridges for pre-established electronic nicotine delivery systems, I would say that's more of a sort of prohibition piece, because They are underage, so I can't buy. So before, in the past, if I had to buy alcohol, they would do shoulder tapping. So I'd go to 7-Eleven and I ask an adult to buy me alcohol. Nowadays, it's simplified process. I can go on eBay and with a Visa prepaid credit card have the nicotine devices delivered to home. And sometimes I might choose the ones that are made from a generic brand. And unfortunately, what we see with a lot of these products, including the brand name products, including some labels and brand name cartridges, is that they are, because they are unregulated and because there is no little to no research or long-term research behind them, we don't know what the negative effects are going to be. We know less about what the negative effects can be on youth usage, for example, on physical and brain development. So that is most definitely an aftershock, not just for youth, but for adults as well, because you're buying generic off-brand products just like anything else, and then you don't know what you're receiving, and we even if we do know, we don't know what the long-term effects of use are as of yet.
I'll sort of jump in here again. Hi, Coach Coffin, glad you're here. The question, though, was around, like, what are we seeing in terms of sort of the recent news that we've seen around some of the deaths associated with vaping, and how have our students been responding? And I think that's part of the conversation is the fact checks, right? It's been a lot of the rumor mill dispelling that it's not harmful, right? And I think one of the things that Coach Coffin actually talks about quite honestly in health with the students is there are. And at the time, you know, we maybe didn't know what they looked like, and now we're getting some concreteness to this. I also think that what's to our benefit, unfortunately in some ways, is that when things do become sensational, right, in the news, our students tend to pay a little bit more attention, so it does give us an opportunity to have those conversations around the risks and those unintended outcomes that we don't even know about because they're still sort of unfolding in real time. So I know those have been some of the honest and frank conversations that take place in health instruction from a naive place too for many of our students around there's not really a risk associated. So it does give us that opportunity to sort of use real time info as well.
Great question. First of all, the question was, have we considered the vape detectors in certain bathrooms, and what are we doing to monitor the restrooms? At the high school, we have a team of security folks. We have Securitas, three members, as well as several employees who will go throughout the day, including my administration team, to check the bathrooms, whether it's during our Mustang block, which is kind of our advisory period where kids kind of have free reign to roam, as well as during lunches. So we have kind of a set rotation in terms of making sure that all of those areas are monitored and checked on a regular basis. I have looked into some of these devices. There's one in particular called FlySense, and so I was on the phone with the representative, I want to say late last spring. And you know, if you do some research, what you'll recognize is that, you know, a lot of these devices, they're not proven to be 100% accurate. And you know, they'll tell you, oh well, we detect up to a certain percentage, this is how it works. And so, you know, that's something that we're still trying to figure out. Obviously work with Dr. Noonan to make sure that's something that we want to engage in. But all the research that I've done right now is they're not as effective as maybe they're marketed to be.
Similarly, we've stepped up our security sweeps in between classes, and at the middle school, things do tend to still be a social event, and so at lunches in particular, we can kind of keep eye and have a more watchful presence at that time. But in regards to the bathroom, we do have the obviously privacy stalls, but for most of the facilities in the middle school, the doors are open, so we're able to sort of see who's gone in and who's gone out, and that's been helpful in us being able to track down maybe what we might have smelled or someone smelled later coming in, to help sort of identify maybe who or whom might have been in the bathroom. But again, it's still sort of a communal experience for the younger kids, and they do sort of talk, which is helpful for us. But we've increased our security in between classes and hall changes because that's the time that we had some challenges.
Thank you.
So the question was, how do we handle if we find a device or someone using a device on school property? As Dr. Noonan alluded to, our board just revisited the policy, and so we have a clear kind of discipline matrix for what a student would receive consequent-wise if they are found, and so we follow that to a T. We're talking about typically an in-school suspension if a student is found on the premises with a device or using, and there are subsequent consequences that would follow based on, you know, if the infraction continues. So it's pretty cut and dry in terms of what we do, and we follow our board policies.
And conversations with families.
Oh, absolutely. And reaching out to families, engaging them, and making sure that, like we said, this is a partnership, you know. So do we believe that a day of in-school suspension is automatically going to change the behavior? We'd like to believe that it's going to make them think twice about what they're doing. But more importantly, it's about making sure that we have kind of that restorative piece, which is what are some of the things that the students can actually think and engage in as to why it's a problem. And working with the families to be partners and say, okay, how can we make sure that this is something that they never do again in school or out of school? See, go for it.
I think part of my question was just answered, but I just wondered if you could tell us a little bit more about what the policy is that was just passed on the school board.
I can speak to it a little bit. You know, one of the things we could do also is include that additional policy in the materials that we're going to put up so that it's available for everybody to see. But essentially, it's I don't want to say zero tolerance because it doesn't really speak to consequence necessarily. It's really about what is the policy around tobacco products and the like, and they're just not allowed on school property. So if a student is found, or a teacher for that matter, there are consequences for both. Yes, sir. You want to speak to that? Yep.
So at the high school, for example, we have a student services team that will typically meet with our students to kind of discuss the why behind it. As we talked about, this is a learning process, right? So this is not a one and done where you get the consequence and we kind of move on. So we include our counseling team, psychologist, social worker, to make sure that the students recognize that this is something that could ultimately, as we saw from Leo, you know, hurt them. And so that's the teaching component that is very, and I know the middle school is doing something very similar, so that's kind of the additional piece.
Yeah, one of the things that some school divisions in the general area have are ATOD programs, or alcohol, tobacco, and other drug programs, that if a student is found in possession of, then those students would go to that ATOD program sort of as an adjudicated piece of their consequence and discipline. We sort of have taken the approach where it's much more individualized and more work with the families and asking for that support a little bit differently. So we are providing similar education from the perspective of when they meet with a school counselor, meet with a social worker, psychologist, family, they get some of the similar information, but they just don't go off to a class. So I don't know if that was the genesis of the question.
Yeah, that is. And I had a follow-up. It's kind of a silly question, but I thought about limiting the number of bathrooms students can use. Like, is there more bathrooms than there are needed in this building?
So the question was, for the good of the video, is there any thought about limiting the number of bathrooms that can be used, or are there too many bathrooms in this building? You know, not knowing exactly how many bathrooms there are, I can tell you that just from a code perspective, there are required numbers of bathrooms. I do know that there have been school systems around the country that have locked down certain bathrooms throughout the day. And that certainly is a strategy. I will say this, though, and it kind of goes back to the point that you made earlier, and I would only push back to say that this is happening everywhere. It's actually not just happening in the bathrooms. We have kids that are doing this in the hallway. We have kids that are doing it in the cafeteria, and we just don't see it. And we're working hard to be vigilant about it. But I would submit to those of you that are here tonight that it's much more pervasive across the school than just the bathroom. So I hear your question. It's one that we, even in the new design of the new high school, are sort of paying attention to in terms of visual and we call it passive supervision, and being able to provide that passive supervision is going to be really important as well. So, all right, well, we'll go Ari.
I just wondered what we might smell.
So the question is what we might smell, or if we're in an environment somebody is vaping, that's going to depend on any of the 6,000 available flavors. So anywhere from, just to spice it up, Fruit Loops, Frosted Flakes, pancakes, tobacco, for those traditionalists. vanilla bean ice cream. Vanilla bean ice cream with Fruit Loops and Frosted Flakes. So as if you can imagine it, it exists, and it's gonna smell bubblegum. So, you know, if you're in a social setting, suddenly you'll realize that you're smelling something probably sweet or fruity or enticing, and you don't know why, and there's no food around. That may be sort of the case. That's why it's such a weird experience in contrast to cigarette smoke or tobacco smoke or cigar smoke, where it's very sort of dense and sort of impactful. But it's going to vary. It really, really, really is.
Does it have like a odd chemical kind of bad perfume kind of stuff?
So the question is, does it have a chemically or perfume sort of after smell? In my experience, it does not. So if you do smell something, it's usually a sort of a smell indicative of what the flavor is supposed to be.
Yes. What's the prevalence or percentage of parents and adults juuling? So the question really, you know, how many parents or adults are vaping, juuling, which makes it to the kids look like it's acceptable to kids? It's not just what this discussion sounds like. It's more, it's a kid issue. But it's not just kids juuling and vaping. It's 20, 30, 40, you know, who are the other people vaping? And is that a problem?
So the question is, what is the percentage of adults or parents that are actively juuling or using electronic nicotine delivery systems, and how can that be related to youth usage? Did I get that right? Off the bat, I do not have that data right in front of me. Where I go with that is the importance of parents of establishing values and rules within your household. I'll do a little sort of social experiment. Raise your hand if you drink alcohol. Okay. That probably doesn't mean that you are engaging with alcohol use with your underage children, right? That's the conversation that we should be having, right? Especially with juuling, tobacco, alcohol, or any negative behavior, sugar, fats, just any behavior engaging that might hurt my youth development is, hey, even though, not because of it's illegal, not because it's hurtful, it's because it's important to me and I want the best for you. So this is a conversation of why. The other piece of this that I think is very important is that school discipline is not going to change behavior. It might give a negative repercussion. You know, what we found is that positive reinforcement works better than negative reinforcement, and prevention works better than treatment, right? And that's where we come in, that's where I come in, that's why I do this. I don't do this to identify who's juuling and who's not, how can we modify policy in order to accommodate. It's how can I make our youth and how do I make our youth stronger? By talking to you guys. If not, I'd have youth in here. But they won't listen because they're off with the things in their ears. Oh God, every time, I don't know, like they walk around school with the things in their ears. I apologize. And we laugh because we have to, right? Because I want to lighten the load before I tell you that you're the most important people in your child's life. Leo, but they don't listen to me. They tell me that I'm stupid, that I don't know what I'm talking about, that I'm old, that I got gray hair, blah, blah, blah. I got gray hair, so I can say that. You're still the most important person, right? Because most of the time, if I don't say it, they don't hear it. And I've had this conversation with parents, with youth who are in substance abuse treatment facilities, right, who have undergone much more challenges, right? It's the conversations that we start having that are gonna pay dividends down the road. It's the conversations, even if it's a one-sided conversation, that's what we're having. I equate it to alcohol because regardless of my behavior, I would like to think that I can say, hey, even though I'm doing it, this is why I don't want you to do it. Or this is why I don't think it's good, because your brain can be permanently changed by this. Not just when you're in high school, guess what? When you leave high school too. Nobody talks about 18 to 25, right? And young adults, we're also facing the same dilemma in a much less controlled environment. Anybody have any graduating seniors this year? Yeah, right? That's when they take their toolbox with themselves. That's when I go, here you go. I'll leave it with this, and I'm mildly preachy because I'm very passionate about what I do. I heard this a long time ago and it stuck with me, is the job of a parent is not to take away pain from their children. It's to give them the tools to go through that pain, right? I see some nodding faces, and I say pain, but you can take obstacles or issues, because I'll do another social experiment. Raise your hand if you've ever had an obstacle in life. I'm gonna burst your bubble. Your children might have obstacles as well, right? This is just one of them. The other thing that I'll do, and I'll say this and wrap it up, is that part of that individual sort of conversation that can be had is, why are you engaging in this behavior? We know that anxiety, for example, right, is very prevalent in this area, not only in your schools, but many of Fairfax County schools, and there's a million of them. I've gone to almost all of them, right? Guess what nicotine does? Yeah, it calms you down. It reduces anxiety. What a thought, right? Right? It works. So if I'm a youth and this is cool and I get nervous and this makes me less nervous, I have a reason to utilize it, right? That's where we come in and be like, oh, well, maybe it's because, you know, because they might not verbalize it, their anxiety is rising, therefore increasing their juuling. But it's like, oh, I get stressed out. Well, what can we do to work with that? How can we de-stress? That sort of thing. So you're getting into that prevention where we're developing things to overcome the behavior, not just band-aiding it, or you're staying home. Anybody else? Yes.
I do think the messaging is working. I monitor my kids' social media feeds, and I'm all of them using
social
media. That's good. One thing that I'm seeing, and this sort of makes me sad for them, is that there are a lot of kids who I will see through social media, they'll be saying they're trying to quit, they're trying to stop. But I really think, and I think your presentation really did it, it's very addictive, it's very addictive very quickly. And I think there are a lot of kids who want to see on social media that are trying to stop. And so they are educated. They know what the problem is. It's how do they stop now that they are done for so long. And I think that's something that they're struggling with. And I don't know really what to say about how to get help.
So the commentary is about the lack of resources on cessation, or the struggles that youth might face when they are physically dependent on nicotine, for example, and they're struggling to quit or stop using.
Maybe one last question.
Yeah.
What are the kind of signs, the physiological behavioral signs, especially when you just started?
So the question is, what are the physiological signs of somebody who just started vaping, or the behaviors? So if you just started, these are going to be very general and very vague for a reason. Because if I just started engaging this behavior, I might not be physically dependent, but I might be a little bit more secretive. So there's a bag that I might always keep close to me and closed. I might always lock the door, or I might be very wary. I might smell very sweet or have certain smells that don't seem cologne-like or deodorant-like. Other than being that privacy or secrecy piece, there's not much you can do. Now, when you're going into nicotine withdrawals, you will have physical symptoms just like you would if you were nicotine withdrawing from cigarettes or the funny thing with nicotine withdrawal is that it's so mild that I can go on about my day, but it's harsh enough where it impacts pretty much my whole demeanor. So irritability, mild aches, much like caffeine withdrawal, where I might be a little bit more irritable, I might be there's a craving and urge to for nicotine. So they're just a little feeling on edge, you might say. And for youth, for example, going back to the previous comment, that's a new experience, right? Because if I'm a youth and I'm going through all that, I struggle with regular day-to-day emotions anyway, right? Remember that the way that I frame it is youth are still trying to figure this out. Everything. If you've ever met or are an adult that are still trying to figure it out, you can imagine how hard it is for them, where I can't figure out regular emotions. Imagine adding some spiciness to that, where now I have another thing to deal with, and I have exams, and we're mid-year, and I might be graduating, and I gotta do this, and I gotta do that, and I, you know, the pressure builds up. Does that make sense?
I'm going to turn it back to Sue just in a second, but before I do, I just want to say thanks again for coming, and thank you, Sue Dimmock, for putting this on. I think it's a great opportunity to come and hear from, you are the expert, and then also hear from our principals. So I'll turn it back to you, but thank you all for being here.
Thank you all for coming tonight. Many thanks to our wonderful principals and superintendent for extending their day to talk with us about this. Many thanks to Leo for taking his time to teach us about vaping and what's going on in our schools. Again, if you didn't fill out or sign in, please do, and we will send you a survey to ask you what you might want to hear from in future talks. Thank you very much for coming. Have a good night.